Hello, my name is Lee Ben Hussein, and I'm an applications engineer at Texas Instruments supporting isolated gate drivers with the high voltage power group. Today, I'll be discussing design considerations and best practices when using the UCC2122X, UCC2152X, and UCC2154X gate drivers in system designs. TI's gate driver families serve a variety of functions and applications. We'll dive deeper into gaining a better understanding of TI's isolated driver strategy and how TI as a company delivers robust and high-performance gate drivers. Design with high-power gate drivers presents many challenges. In order to maximize performance and efficiency, there are several design considerations and best practices to keep in mind, whether this is input filtering or external component selection. By implementing these best practices, designers can ensure that their overall system performs to its highest ability. TI is a leader in the isolated gate driver industry. Our devices are reliable, robust, efficient, and flexible in the applications they are intended for. These include, but are not limited to, power factor correction, motor drives, solar string inverters, as well as traction inverters. Some of our gate drivers have working voltages that exceed 2 kilovolts and zero EMI radiation, resulting in more flexible and robust system designs. Other gate drivers have over 100 million reliability hours of testing, and CMTI ratings exceeding 200 volts per nanosecond, ensuring that the driver has a long product lifetime. Some of our high-performance drivers can output up to 30 amps drive current, while others have great timing characteristics with delay matching less than 5 nanoseconds. These performance parameters help to create more efficient, lower-cost systems. Finally, our devices come in a variety of package sizes, ultimately reducing costs and overall sizes for PCBs. Here, we see an example of the typical application circuit for a high-voltage half-bridge driver, as seen in the UCC2122X, UCC2152X, and UCC2154X datasheets. The datasheet is the best source of information on system design recommendations and how they can be implemented in one's design. Now, this isn't the only way to design a half-bridge circuit, but this schematic provides a general overview, in addition to detailing key considerations and best practices such as input filtering, and bootstrap component selection for optimal system performance, as we'll see shortly. All inputs need to be properly filtered. Improper input filtering can lead to a variety of undesirable effects, including unwanted electromagnetic interference being introduced into the system. Furthermore, non-ideal layout, or long PCB traces, can cause signal integrity issues to the inputs resulting from inductances in the input signal loop, or coupled noise from the power stage. This can result in noise being injected to the internal circuitry, resulting in reduced overall system efficiency. To mitigate these effects, use an input resistance, Rin, up to 100 ohms, and an input capacitance, Cin, ranging between 10 picofarads and 100 picofarads. Rin and Cin can have significant effects on reducing signal integrity issues from the input. Further details on input filtering and the effects this can have on one's system performance can be referenced in the linked application note. Separating the controller from the disabled by a distance of a few inches or more can introduce unwanted parasitic inductances that can cause ringing, for reasons similar to those mentioned previously. In this case, if the disable function is required, use a low ESR/ESL capacitor with a value of approximately 1 nanofarad to reduce these effects. If no disable is required, tie the disable pin to ground in order to deactivate this function and to achieve better noise immunity. Programmable dead time can be set by the user by placing a resistor between the dead time pin and ground. Half-bridge driver topologies require that both FETs are never switched on at the same time. This is in order to prevent shoot-through, which can damage the device. Programming the dead time to provide sufficient time between each input switching high is necessary for proper operation. However, just as the disable, in A, and in B pins require filtering for optimal performance, similar considerations must be taken into account for the dead time pin. A floating dead time pin, as seen in the first figure, should be avoided to prevent noise from coupling in and disturbing the dead time duration. If programming the dead time through a dead time resistor, place a capacitor in parallel with a value greater than 2.2 nanofarads to increase noise immunity during fast switching transients. If no dead time is required, tie the dead time pin to VCCI to deactivate the dead time circuit. Minimizing startup time is key to designing a circuit that is both energy efficient as well as fast. Startup delay is limited by VDDx power-up delay, and this can happen for a few reasons, but it's primarily determined by the driver being used, the time it takes the bootstrap capacitor to reach the UVLO level, as well as a typical power-up delay of the driver. This value differs between the UCC2122X, UCC2152X, and UCC2154X, but the overall principle of operation is the same. All isolated drivers, when used in a bootstrap configuration, have high side pulse delay when V-boot starts below the UVLO threshold. Although the VDDx power-up delay of the driver cannot really be controlled, the delay associated with the charging of the bootstrap capacitor can be limited in two ways. The first and most effective way to do so is to include a programmed startup sequence, as seen in the figure below. This startup sequence allows the bootstrap capacitor to charge before the driver is actually needed as a result of planning for the delay. The power-up delay can also be reduced by adjusting the bootstrap components, more specifically, R-boot and C-boot. Adjusting these values to be minimized, while still limiting bootstrap capacitor overcharge and high side supply DVDT, is crucial for optimal performance. Further information can be found in the FAQ linked below. Gate oscillations can have several detrimental effects on one system performance. Increased power losses and false switching are just a couple of examples of the negative effects that gate oscillations can have, leading to permanent FET damage. Furthermore, DIDT from stray inductances and parasitics can influence the formation of resonant circuits, increasing gate oscillations and yielding further damage. To mitigate these effects, use good layout practices as outlined in the UCC21540 datasheet to reduce large DVDT and DIDT loops that can influence these oscillations. Place a larger gate resistor to dampen the gate oscillation, or place a ferrite bead between 30 and 100 ohms at 100 MHz to help ensure stable operation. For further details on designing with the larger gate resistor, please refer to the link tech note. Selecting suitable bootstrap components is critical to ensuring one system performs as intended. Lack of doing so can lead to high DVDT spikes, which can have several detrimental effects, including supply overshoot and gate driver ESD protection cell activation. Over time, these effects can damage the driver. In addition, high diode peak currents beyond the recommended maximum over time can damage the bootstrap diode. To reduce these effects, use a bootstrap resistor as seen in the second figure. Bench results confirm the effects that using a bootstrap resistor, or lack thereof, can have on reducing the diode peak current significantly. With no bootstrap resistor, the diode peak current is measured to be 29.4 amps, which could cause serious damage to the bootstrap diode. Placing a 4 ohm resistor in series with the bootstrap diode reduces the diode peak current to 3.36 amps, yielding a reduction that's almost 9 times smaller in overall peak current. The bootstrap capacitor also plays a critical role in proper bootstrap supply operation. Sizing the bootstrap capacitor to be 50 to 100 times the gate capacitance is necessary to not only power the high side FET in a half bridge topology, but to reduce overall VDD ripple. In addition to this, bootstrap overcharge and DVDT across the bias supply of the driver need to be taken into account, and properly selecting bootstrap capacitor and resistor values to maintain these parameters within operable levels is critical for optimal performance. For further details on considerations for R-boot and C-boot in bootstrap supply design, you can refer to the attached FAQs. This concludes the best practices presentation. If you have any questions, you can find us on ETE, and we'll make sure to get back to you in 24 hours with a response. We have FAQs for a variety of topics relating to gate drivers, as well as previously answered questions, and are more than happy to help with any further inquiries.